In the last class, we were discussing about the introduction to Module 2. And in Module 2, we said we'll be considering how to represent the signals, binary signals, which we transmit in the form of a set of orthonormal functions or orthogonal functions. And it's a linear equation. We are going to write linear equations to represent every message as a set of, using a set of orthonormal basis functions. And later on, once we transmit the message, we can also use a vector transmitter as part of the transmitter, where each symbol will be represented as a set of vector numbers, say SI, SI1, SI2, so on. Then we would modulate where each of these SI values would be converted to a finite energy signal, which will travel on the channel. That finite energy signal usually are in the form of sines or cosines. Okay. And when they travel on the channel, we know noise in the form of additive white Gaussian noise gets added. So AWGN, we call it in short. This noise gets added to the signal on the channel. And then we receive the signal. At the receiver, we are going to receive the sum of the signal transmitted, SI of T, along with the received noise signal, that is W of T. Okay. So we would be receiving SI plus W. Here AWGN is represented as W, and the signal which was transmitted was in the form of SI of T. So that is what we receive. We can also call it as an unknown signal or an unknown random signal X of T. This combination SI plus W, we called it as unknown random signal X of T. Now, what should the receiver do? The job of the receiver is to observe this unknown signal. So there is an unknown signal. It should observe that unknown signal for 1 bit duration. What is 1 bit duration normally, which we consider? TB seconds. So it should observe this unknown symbol, which it has received for 1 bit duration. And then it should make a decision whether that received symbol is a 1 or a 0. And in order for it to make that decision, it should perform proper detection, and it should go through demodulation, the vector receiver and all that. And once it is able to make a detection and estimation of whether the given received data is a 1 or a 0, then it will be sent to the destination. As I was telling you, receivers, when we think about receivers, we have to think about error, probability of error. That means if the transmitted symbol was same as the received symbol, then we say the probability of error is 0. And if the received symbol is different from the transmitted symbol, then there is a probability of error. Okay. And we considered all this yesterday. The source is always supposed to have M alphabets, capital M. We named them as M1, M2 till MM. And these M symbols will be emitted every T seconds, and we assume all symbols are emitted with equal probability. It's considered as a zero memory source. So since we emit M symbols, capital M symbols, all of which are equiprobable, then the probability of generating the symbol MI, any one message MI, can be considered as 1 by m. And output of the vector transmitter will be in the form of a vector having real numbers. So SI, I am going to consider, it would be including a vector SI1, SI2 till SIN. Okay. And remember, I varies from 1 to M, the number of messages generated. And one more thing, what we should remember when we express it in the form of a vector is that the number of elements in the vector capital N should always be less than the number of message symbols capital M. So please remember, whenever you express the given message as a vector, you should always consider number of elements in the vector to be less than the number of symbols in the message. And then the energy of this signal. We said we are going to convert all these vector symbols to finite energy signals in the form SI of t. Each of these would be represented by finite energy signals. That signal was represented as SI of t, and the energy content of that signal can be found as integral 0 to t SI square t. Okay, that's how we find the energy in a signal. Next, the signal travels through the channel where it gets affected with additive white Gaussian noise. We name it as white noise, W of t. So the received signal is an unknown random signal in the form of X of t, which would be obtained as the sum of the transmitted signal plus the additive white Gaussian noise W of t. So this is how we represent the received signal. A random process can be represented in the form of all capital values, and the actual received signal will be a sample of this random process. Okay, so the receiver is considered as a random process which will receive the transmitted and the white noise. Now, the received signal is a sample function of the random process as it is shown here. It's just the versions, a simple version of the same received signal. And that's what we represented in the form of a simple block diagram, where this was the transmitted signal SI of t. White noise was added inside the channel, and this received signal was X of t. Okay. Now, we also consider, like, if the receiver, I can have two types of receivers, as we know. The receiver can be what? A coherent or synchronous receiver. We have studied all these types in PCS. What do you mean by a coherent or synchronous receiver? Yes. What's the meaning of coherent or synchronous receiver? Please answer. What are you people doing?
Signals having same frequency and acting constantly.
The transmitter's clock and the receiver's clock should have the same frequency and phase. Then we call it as a coherent or synchronous receiver. Okay. And asynchronous means both should have different frequencies. The local oscillator or the clock, in terms of digital transmission, we call them as clock frequencies. The clock frequencies of transmitter and receiver should match in a coherent or synchronous receiver. Here, the clock frequencies are different. Both will have different clock frequencies and phase. Usually, phase will not match. Frequency, often we keep it matching. So I can have one of the two types of receivers. And other than that, I can also define the probability of error, total probability of error at receiver as the sum of, let me write it something like this, pi 1 into p, when m cap is equal to 0, but 1 was sent, plus pi 2 into probability that the received symbol was a 1 and 0 was sent. So the total probability of error at receiver can be represented like this. Okay. Here pi 1 and pi 2 can be the a priori probabilities, or what do you call probabilities which was known beforehand at the transmitter. Okay. So a priori probabilities of transmitting symbols, let's say 0 and 1, or 1 and 0 I'll write. So the probability that 1 was sent, I can say, was pi 1, and the probability that 0 was sent, I can call it pi 2. Okay. So they are probabilities which are known beforehand. That's why we call them a priori probabilities. Pi 1 and pi 2 represent the earlier known probabilities of transmitting symbols 1 and 0. So when I transmit symbol 1, its probability was pi 1. The probability of transmission of symbol 0 was pi 2. Now, what can be the total probability of error at the receiver? The probability that 1 was transmitted. So probability that 1 was transmitted into probability of receiving a 0 when 1 was transmitted. What do you call this kind of probability as? Probability of receiving a 0 when we had sent 1. What did we call this as? In ITC you have studied conditional probability. We have put the condition here. Actually, I had transmitted a 1 with probability pi 1, but I have received a 0. Hence, it's a conditional probability which I am multiplying with this. This indicates error. Similarly, the other condition of error can be probability that a 0 was transmitted. Probability of transmitting a 0 pi 2 into the conditional probability that 1 was received when 0 was sent. Okay, so this represents a conditional probability that I have received 1 when I sent a 0. So again, this is a condition of error. So please understand this. Probability of error can be represented as the sum of these two values, which we represent as shown in this equation. Okay. Now, just to conclude, let's say, to conclude the digital communication system, we should have our main motivation to design, efficient digital communication system is what? To minimize the probability of error at the receiver. So I should have a receiver which is reliable. So a reliable receiver or a reliable communication is possible if we receive what we send. Rather than receiving something else, we send something, receive something else, then it's not a reliable communication system. So I am talking something, you are receiving or understanding something else. Then there is no point in communication at all. Only if what I speak and convey reaches you, that is a reliable communication system. And if I should have a reliable communication system, the probability of error at the receiver should be minimum. So that's how we have to design a reliable communication system. So for this, what should we do? Two important considerations we should make. The first consideration is the receiver should be optimally designed to minimize the probability of error. So we have to choose the design of a receiver by making an optimized choice so that I'll have least probability of error. What is transmitted should be received. So you should design the receiver. We have very good examples of receivers. Here we have a correlation receiver or matched filter receiver. A matched filter receiver. We'll be studying different types of receivers which help us achieve a very optimized design where probability of error will be minimum. Okay. And the second important condition is that we should choose the set of symbols in the transmitter so that it will give an efficient representation of the message. How do I write this? Let me say choice of the set of signals S1, S2, so on till SM of T at the transmitter to best represent the message symbols M1, M2, so on, MM, right? So I have to choose the signals optimally or in the best possible way it should represent the message. In that case, the effect of channel noise will be minimized so that effect of AWGN channel noise is minimized. So you have to make a very efficient choice of the symbol set which will represent the messages. So you have a set of messages and every message you are going to represent as a set of symbols. And when you do that representation, you have to consider optimal or very good representation so that the noise effect on those symbols is minimized. Okay. So this is about the brief introduction to a digital communication system design. Now, let's consider the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure. So this is a very, very important and very, very useful procedure whenever we need to represent digital messages. Whenever I have to represent digital messages and I have to get a suitable symbol to transmit them properly on a noisy channel, this Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization procedure helps us to do that efficiently. Okay. So to start off, let's consider the representation. Let the message symbols MI where I is represented as 1 till m, b transmitted from the discrete source. So this is a derivation. All of you please write down correctly. So we have transmitted the message mi from the discrete source. The set of m finite energy signals, m finite energy signals, SI of t used to represent mi can be written as a, let's say, linear combination of n orthonormal basis functions. And remember, here n should always be less than or equal to m. The message symbols are m in number, capital M in number, and the number of orthonormal basis functions which we are going to use to represent the m message symbols should always be n, which is less than or equal to m. Okay. And n is, remember, orthonormal basis functions. The n represents linearly independent functions. So each function is independent of the other. Please remember, it will represent linearly independent functions. Now let's start off by assuming what those functions are. Let phi 1, phi 2, so on, phi n of t be a set of real orthonormal basis functions each exists for a duration t seconds. Okay, so we are considering these values phi 1, phi 2, phi n to be the set of orthonormal basis functions. Okay, and I think yesterday, just before doing this, we started off trying to understand few important properties, right, of signals, vector space concept. And we defined a signal space S of t to contain a set of m signals or n signals S1, S2 till Sn, and the various operations which could be performed on these signals are like inner product, which is nothing but correlation, norm, finding the energy, orthogonality, distance or Euclidean distance, and orthogonal basis. So I think we were trying to understand this, and we considered a signal something like this, whose value was 0 for t less than 0 and t greater than capital T. The energy in this signal would be integral from 0 to t s square t dt, and it should be a finite energy signal less than infinity. Then we found the inner product of two functions x of t and y of t. How do we represent the inner product? It is integral of the product of the two functions x of t into y of t, and which is integrated in the interval 0 to t. because both these functions x and y are present in the time interval 0 to t. Okay, and we compared it with the vector notation. The vector notation shows two vectors x and y with an angle theta separating them, and the inner product of the two vectors x and y is given as x into y into cos theta. We also called this as dot product, right? And we took an example where we wrote two signals as shown, and we tried to find the inner product or dot product of these two signals. And when we do it, we consider the interval from 0 to t by 2 first. The interval from here to here was 0 to t by 2. Right? And this value is a, and this value is a by 2. So a into a by 2 in the interval t by 2 plus, here this is minus a and this is plus 2a. So minus a into plus 2a in the interval t by 2. The sum of both together is what we got as the dot product or inner product, right? So we did this yesterday, and we were trying to discuss the other functions also. This is just a recall of other operations on signals. The second function is the norm function. How do we find the norm function? The norm of a signal x of t can be root of its energy. You see, how do we define the norm? Or if I take norm of norm value, which gives x of t square, it is nothing but the inner product of x of t with itself. And how do I represent an inner product? Integral of the square of the given signal in the interval 0 to t, which is nothing but energy of the signal. So the norm of any signal will be the root of its energy. So root ex, please remember that. And again, norm of a vector. If x is a vector, its norm is also defined in the same format. The comparison is shown always. Okay. So energy of the vector is x square. Hence, norm of the vector will be what? X as shown. Then we have another example where we have taken a cosine signal. How do we represent this cosine signal? This cosine signal is written as a cos 2 pi by t, where capital T represents the time period. So a cos 2 pi ft we would call. 1 by capital T is f. Okay. So please understand this 1 by capital T is the frequency here. And this signal is represented as a cos 2 pi ft. And how do I find its norm? I have to first find the energy in the signal, which is integral 0 to t a cos 2 pi ft the whole square dt. And when I try to find the value of this energy, it turns out that that value will be root t by 2. So the energy a into root t by 2 represents the what? Norm of the signal, and it is root of its energy function. Please remember, a norm is always the root, square root of its energy function. Okay. Next, the other operation, orthogonality. How do we define orthogonality of two signals? If the inner product of the two signals turns out to be zero, then we say the two signals are orthogonal in nature. So how do I represent that? X of t and y of t are the two signals. Their inner product is defined as integral 0 to t x of t into y of t dt. If this is 0, then x of t is orthogonal to y of t. Remember that. So we can consider an example here of a cosine. This cosine signal is as shown. And let's say we are representing this cosine signal as this. And y of t represents a square signal as shown. Can we say they are orthogonal to each other? Can a square and cosine be orthogonal? You have to find the inner product of these two signals. If you say, if you call this as x of t and this as y of t, if I try to multiply the two values x of t into y of t in the interval 0 to t, in this, will you get this as 0? Looking at this waveform itself, you can tell. Will it be 0 or not? See, here the value is A, here the value is B. So A into B at 0, I am going to get it as A into B, which is not 0. Here, it is minus A into minus B. So I may have minus A into minus B. So you have to multiply the whole cosine signal. I can say cosine signal. I can just write it in this form. Let me say. How do I write it? X of t can be written as A cos 2 pi f t. F, I'm going to write it as 1 by t into t. A cos 2 pi f t. This is x of t. And y of t, what? Is nothing but it has the value b, the amplitude of this signal. It's a rectangular function with amplitude b. So you just have to multiply these two and apply the limits 0 to t. You integrate first. Let me write the integral function. And then after integrating this cosine into b. Okay. So what is integral of cosine? Can't you directly tell whether this will be a 0 or not? Comparing these two, are these signal orthogonal to each other? Do I need to find out all this? What is integral of cosine? A sine 2 pi t by t divided by 2 pi by t. And this is of the value b. This you should integrate in the interval 0 to t. So you try to find out this. It will turn out that the value is not 0. If this inner product is not 0, then they are not orthogonal signals. But you can easily say a sine and cosine are orthogonal. So if I have one signal which is a sine and another which is a cosine, you'll find out that they will be orthogonal in nature. And how do we represent orthogonal signals as vectors? You see, if this is the vector x in the first quadrant, the vector y will be there in the second quadrant with a 90 degree phase shift. That is the meaning of orthogonal. The two signals will be orthogonal if there is a 90 degree phase change between the two signals, as you can see in the vector representation. Okay. So I hope all of you know and have understood what is orthogonality. Next, let's see, for example, orthonormal functions, some examples of orthonormal functions. So if I have two signals, x of t and y of t, here you can see the examples taken are a cosine and a sine. The upper one is a cosine signal. The lower one is a sine signal. And if their inner product is 0 and the norm of both are one, then we call such signals as orthonormal signals. Please understand this carefully. We were talking of orthonormal signals just now. What are orthonormal functions or orthonormal signals? Orthonormal signals are those where the inner product of the two signals is zero, which means they are orthogonal in nature. So if two signals are orthogonal, two signals are orthogonal to each other, which means the integral of their product will be zero. Remember that when I integrate the product of those two signals, if it results in a zero, they are called orthogonal. And the norm value of each of these signals turns out to be one, then we call such functions as orthonormal functions. Please remember, orthonormal signals or orthonormal functions. So how do I represent the norm? Remember, norm is nothing but root of the energy value. Here, if the energy in each signal should be one. So please remember, if the signal should be orthonormal, it is like it should satisfy the orthogonality property. Inner product should be zero. It should also satisfy the norm property, where the energy content of both the signals should be unity, one. So when it satisfies both these, such signals are called orthonormal signals. Okay, hope now there is some clarity about what are orthonormal signals. Please remember that sine and cos are the best example of a pair of orthonormal signals. You see, with the amplitudes, what we have considered root T by T as the peak amplitude. If I try to multiply these two and integrate in the interval 0 to t, you will surely get 0 as the answer. And if you try to find the energy under a sine or the energy under a cosine, both turns out to be 1. Okay. So how do we represent this? How do I define this correlation coefficient? The correlation coefficient, generally defined as rho, is equivalent to the inner product of the two signals divided by the product of the norm of the two signals. See, I have taken the norm of x of t and the norm of y of t, and we are multiplying both in the denominator. Here we have taken energy, norm is nothing but root of energy. So when I replace the exact formulae for the numerator and denominator, what's the numerator? Numerator represents the inner. Okay, the correlation coefficient is defined as the inner product of the two signals, which is represented by the integral of x of t into y of t, divided by root of the energy in the two signals, or norm, product of the norm of the individual signals. Same thing we could represent using vectors like this, where this rho was known as the correlation coefficient in vectors. It is the dot product of the two vectors x and y divided by the norm of the two vectors. Okay. So there is an example signal showing the same. You see, we are considering x of t as a rectangular pulse of amplitude 10a in the interval 0 to t, and y of t as another pulse minus 8. You just note down this, and I want you to try calculating this at home. So I haven't written all the details, individual steps. I have just written the main steps. Please note down this and try to complete the individual steps at home. Okay. So how you multiply, this is from 0 to t, it's a constant value x, whereas y changes from 0 to t by 2, it has some value. From t by 2 to 7 t by 8, it has a different value. Okay. So as usual, the correlation coefficient is x into y divided by root ex into root ey. We are trying to find the energy in these signals. Energy in x of t will be 10a into root t, because 10a into t will give you the area under the curve, and root of that you will get root e of x. Similarly, this area under this curve, which gives you the energy, will be root 7/8 a into root t. You can just calculate this. Please make a note and calculate. Okay. Let's not go into detailed analysis here. The next important parameter which we have to see is the Euclidean distance between two signals. We'll again be finding this commonly. Everywhere in this chapter, we'll be talking about inner product, Euclidean distance and all that. So how do we define the Euclidean distance? The Euclidean distance d square will be x of t minus y of t norm, a whole square, okay? Or I can take it in terms of integral as x of t minus y of t whole square in the interval 0 to t, okay? So what would be the value of this? If I consider this expanded, it will be x square of t, integral 0 to t x square of t would be energy in the signal x. And integral 0 to t y square t would be energy in the signal y, ex and ey. Then I am going to have 2 times what? Root ex into root ey into rho. We already know how we defined rho. Okay. So if you expand this, it will be d square is equal to ex plus ey plus 2 rho into root of ex into ey. Please make a note of that. That's how you define the Euclidean distance. And if both the signals have the same energy, say both are x or something, both have the same amount of energy, this d square will become e plus e, that is 2e. And this will be root of e square, which is also e. So if I take out e outside as common, I'll get 2e into 1 minus rho. Simplification of this. If both the energies are the same, if energy in both are same, then that would be E plus E minus 2 rho into E, or 2E into 1 minus rho. Okay. And then we have something known as antipodal signals, where the rho value would be minus 1. In that case, the Euclidean distance becomes 2 into root of the energy. So here, if this correlation coefficient value becomes minus 1, then it will be 2 into root e. Here 1 minus of minus 1 will be 2. So I'll have 2 square into e. You just substitute in this formula. What happens when rho becomes minus 1? It becomes 2 square or 4 times e. Or if I'm interested in finding just the value of the distance d, instead of d square, I'm interested in d, it becomes 2 root of the energy. And remember, both signals should have equal energy here. And if rho is 0, which we say it is true for an orthogonal, for two orthogonal signals. If x and y are orthogonal, then rho will be 0. What happens if rho is equal to 0? It will be root of 2e. The value of distance would be root of 2e. Okay. So equal energy signals and all that. Some examples, say x of t is a cos 2 pi f naught t and y of t is minus a cos 2 pi f naught t. Then this is how we choose the signals in phase shift keying. This is one of the digital modulation techniques. This is how we are going to choose the signals in phase shift keying. You see here what happens. These are antipodal, or if you find the value of d, it turns out to be minus 1 in this case. For x of t and y of t being opposite, it turns out to be minus 1. So that would be the example for equal energy signals. Similarly, we have equal energy orthogonal signals where x is a cos 2 pi f1 and y is a cos 2 pi f0. F1 and f0 will be different frequencies. It will be chosen in such a way that they are orthogonal to each other. So these are some of the examples. We'll deal with all these signals in the next class. So just have a look at inner product, norm, orthogonality, correlation coefficient, distance. These are the various things we discussed. All